Hey everybody, this is Pamela.
And this is Kyle.
And we are here to discuss how business really works. So today we have a guest. You can see Tracy is not here with me today, but I have my friend and colleague Kyle Rollins from Mammoth Solutions. I've done some videos with Kyle in the past, and we've covered all kinds of topics that you may be interested in, from keyword research to marketing to branding yourself. I will link to some of those in the description so you can check them out if you are watching the video. But today I brought Kyle back as our guest on How Business Really Works to talk about mobile design. And there is so much to know. We're gonna go over stats of mobile usage, how you design for mobile in the first place, considerations you need to make, and really why you should even care about this. So,
yep.
Kyle, welcome back.
It's good to be back.
Good to have you. So let's start out with the stats. What are the stats for mobile usage? If I want to browse a website or shop online or do whatever,
yep.
What is it now?
So people said for years that this is going to be the year that mobile overtakes desktop.
Mm.
And if you define it in just web browsing, this last year was the year where over 50% of web pages viewed were viewed on a mobile device.
And mobile phone.
Mobile phone or
okay.
tablet.
Or
but now it's so clear that it's, even if you just take tablet out and you say mobile phone, it is well over 50% for most clients. A lot of B2B stuff is still majority desktop, like law firms and things like that.
Oh, yeah.
There's just less evening browsing, and we'll talk about that. The majority of mobile page views are during primetime television.
Oh, okay.
And it's called second screen syndrome. You're probably guilty of it. Advertising time, as we get rid of more ads on TV, we watch more recorded television, we have things like Hulu and Netflix with no ads.
Mm-hmm.
People are kind of watching TV or have it on in the background and are looking at their phone at the same time and scrolling through apps like Facebook and things
Facebook,
like that.
Twitter,
and,
I am guilty.
And this video, hopefully. So,
little plug
there.
Definitely should
be watching that. But outside of just web browsing, if you add in apps and app usage as mobile, the numbers are far beyond 50%. They're closer to 75%.
Yeah. Because you can even do online shopping now on apps rather than on the website even.
Yep.
Yeah.
And not all that was ever included. So the mind shift or the paradigm shift has happened.
Mm-hmm.
So even 2 years ago, it was April 20th, 2015, Google said, if you don't have a mobile version, we're going to punish you with SEO.
Of your website.
Yep.
Yeah.
So your ranking is going to be less than someone, a competitor who does have mobile and other things
that.
With them. Yep.
Oh, okay.
So they have a mobile friendly test. You can run your website through and see the grades. And it used to be that it defaulted to the desktop tab, and then there was a mobile tab to grade that version.
Mm-hmm.
But now it defaults to the mobile tab.
Interesting. So, okay.
And we can post that in the space underneath.
Definitely. That's a great resource. And something I didn't even know, that Google was punishing people.
Mm-hmm.
I've got to get on my game here.
The number of requests that came through after April 20th of people saying, I need a mobile version of my website now.
Yesterday.
Really, yeah.
Oh, man. Okay, so let's talk about mobile design. What does mobile design mean, mobile first versus responsive design? Because I have a website. I have several websites. They are responsive design.
Mm-hmm.
And to me that, or maybe to a layperson, that could mean or does mean mobile design. But are they different things? And if so, how?
Yeah, so I would group it into sort of three categories. There's a mobile site versus a website.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's where you have a dedicated mobile version. That's very 1990s
kind of style. Mm-hmm.
The M.dot version of a site or mobile.com.
And I still see that.
Yep.
I still see a lot of m.whatever.com.
And they are graded separately, and Google actually considers that to be a mobile-optimized version.
Okay.
The problem with that is it was probably designed for one screen size. And so even now you have to respond to multiple screen sizes just within the mobile category.
Okay.
So let's forget about that for today. I think that's a really hard topic to talk about, is just the mobile only. So let's categorize it. No, let's just say two, and that's going to be responsive and mobile first. So they're not mutually exclusive.
Okay.
Responsive is when you have a website that, as your browser window changes, whether it's on desktop and you're shrinking it from left to right or up and down, or you're going from mobile, from desktop to mobile, which is tablet or phone, mm-hmm. that the screen size and the elements in the page change. That is responsive.
Right, right.
Mobile first is an approach to dealing with that.
Okay, got it.
So the mobile first approach is saying, typically when we would design a website, we would design for desktop first. And then we would...
The old way.
The old way.
The traditional way, I should say. Yeah.
And then if we wanted to do a mobile version, we would add responsive media queries and all this sort of stuff mm-hmm. and start designing for different screen sizes. Mm-hmm. That is now what we call graceful degradation. So you start out with the big version and you gracefully degrade your site to get to smaller screen sizes. You take away features. You can't fit everything on the mobile version.
So you have literally different versions of your website for different platforms? Or is it that you're calling different elements based on the platform?
You have the same content mm-hmm. available, mm-hmm. and you either show it or hide it, or call different elements and versions of it.
Okay.
But it is one site that responds to those different screen sizes.
Right.
Got it.
Okay.
I wouldn't say it's a different site. You can literally build almost three different versions or more mm-hmm. as you try and set which screen sizes you want to optimize for.
Okay.
And that's part of what mobile first is. So instead of saying the graceful degradation version where we start with desktop and we work our way down, the new way of doing it is to start with the hardest case first, which is the mobile first
right.
version,
mm-hmm.
and then design for that. That is a portrait mode instead of landscape.
Right, yeah.
And then as you add features and you get bigger, that is called progressive enhancement
mm-hmm.
instead of graceful degradation.
Okay, so your progressive enhancement is really the current, the new way of designing sites where
yeah.
you're starting with mobile in mind, you're designing for that portrait screen, the smaller screen size, and then when that's complete, then you go on to add elements,
mm-hmm.
I guess, for larger screen sizes or
and they shift. You may have had on a landscape version of your desktop page,
yeah.
you may have a big hero image across the top and
right.
say a triptych of three icons with three calls to action
mm-hmm.
to
and
segment.
I see those a lot on the desktop.
Yep. Pretty common.
Yeah.
But if you shift that and you go to a smaller screen, you may have the hero image in a portrait mode.
Mm-hmm.
It may have just shrinked up and taken up a portion of the screen instead of 50% of desktop
right.
on portrait,
right.
on landscape, you may say, I only want to take up 25% of portrait on mobile.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. So, and then when those three icons underneath may shift and stack mm-hmm. to be vertical.
Okay.
So we control that stuff. And a lot of that you can get out of the box with themes and things like that that you use. And they're already built. And they respond in a pretty common way. Websites are built in columns, and that's a whole other concept to understand if you're working with somebody to build your website and you want to be engaged in that process. But basically what responsive is telling the columns how to shift.
So based upon usage, which we have a flavor of from the stats you gave us,
mm-hmm.
if you are designing a new website or upgrading an older website, I guess what we're advising really is you should be taking the mobile first approach with a responsive design
mm-hmm.
Because that's the way your users are most likely going to access your website. So I know you've had some experience with this.
I have, and we talked about it beforehand, and
yeah.
should I share this? And I think I should, because I think part of how business really works is being honest about the trials and tribulations
yeah.
and
yeah.
sharing your stumbles so that everybody else doesn't have to do the same thing.
Yes.
And I have no shame.
Me neither.
So I'm happy to share.
Get down to it.
Yeah. I made the mistake of recently working on a site where mobile was very important and not starting with mobile. And had I started with mobile, I think a lot of the issues that came up in the later phases
yeah.
that popped up when we got to the mobile version would have been addressed up front. And it would have saved a lot of time and energy of rework in addition to making everybody happy. It would have been more challenging to get something started, and I think we made the mistake because we were in a hurry
mm-hmm.
and we wanted to meet a deadline, which we did not meet anyway.
Yeah. So that's the challenge.
Balancing expectations and speed and quality and
right.
all those things.
Right.
If I think what happens when you take the desktop version first and the progressive,
graceful degradation.
Graceful degradation process. Mm-hmm. You get committed to concepts and looks and feels that aren't relevant when you get to portrait on a smaller screen.
Yeah.
And so by starting with those same concepts but never getting committed to them on desktop and putting them in mobile, you've got the chance to say, okay, I'm making this work on a small screen and fit my elements and make it look good on a portrait mode, knowing that they're going to shift the landscape as I go to tablet and desktop. And if we had taken that approach, and it would have, yes, yeah, so the first few weeks would have been longer. But when we committed to that, it was much easier to progressively enhance those features mm-hmm. than to start talking about what are we going to take away
right.
now that we're on a smaller screen.
Right. It's easier to build on what you have mm-hmm. than change to go backwards. So, you know, and I take that approach with, I think, life in general. I mean, I'll add a little life lesson here, because in my day-to-day, building how business really works, building my personal YouTube channel, mm-hmm. building Call Time Atlanta, which you've been a part of in the past, mm-hmm. There are so many things to get done. And some of them are, you know, more desirable activities than others. I'm just going to be honest. But, you know, when you're building your own business, you do it all, or you do most of it. And some things you enjoy more than others, but I've made it a practice to get the more difficult things done first, the things maybe I don't even want to do, get those done and get them out of the way, because then the rest is a lot easier. Mm-hmm. And so, I mean, obviously we're talking about mobile design here, so we're talking about a specific technical topic, but I think it is applicable to building your business in general. Mm-hmm. You really need to commit to getting the hardest stuff done first, because the rest will be relatively easier. That's just my advice for today.
And as part of the Agile Project Management Manifesto.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so that is part
of it. Get the hardest business requirements out of the way, because
that's right.
You may realize in that process that you may not want to do something.
Mm-hmm.
And you will find out the what you don't want to do much faster than getting invested in a lot of things and then shredding it all because you found out at the end
right.
it wasn't worthwhile.
Right. I'm just surprised at how many companies don't do it that way. It just blows my mind. But that's another topic. moving on. So we have talked about the mobile-first approach, responsive design, the stats, and why you should be concerned about mobile design in the first place. But what are some constraints of mobile design? It can't be just as easy as putting a mobile portrait site together, and here we go, off into the sunset. So if it were only that easy, everybody would be doing it. But
right. What
constraints do we need to think about when we are designing a mobile site or application?
Yeah. The first set of constraints are the portrait versus landscape. Mm-hmm. The second are screen sizes. And that means talking about things in percentages instead of in absolutes.
Mm-hmm.
If you say this is the pixel size of the font or the pixel width of the image, then that drastically changes based on screen size and layout. So we've moved into different measurements and different ways of building things. Mm-hmm. And I think one thing when you're talking to a agency who's going to build your site for you is find out if they're a print-only shop or whether or not they do digital.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the print-only guys are used to working in absolutes and their minds haven't gotten into designing for web.
Yeah.
And you'll find out midway through the process when you go start getting into the mobile version how disappointed you are.
Yeah. So when you say absolutes, you mean like the width of this page is 100% or the width of this element, an image, a div, you know, class mm-hmm. is 75% or something like that. Or the size of fonts, like you were saying, any size measurement should be percentage based.
For the most part.
Yeah.
Yeah.
rather than a specific, you know, width is 700 pixels.
It's not an absolute.
Okay.
I would say majority of the time we've started working in percentages. Every once in a while we'll throw in some pixels because we do want it the same across the board.
Okay.
But height of the hero image is a common one.
Mm-hmm.
You know, mm-hmm. you used to have sidebars on websites and they're gone now because they don't play well on mobile.
Right.
How do you make a sidebar when the columns all start to shift and everything becomes single column format,
mm-hmm.
how do you put a sidebar in down the side of a mobile screen?
Right, it's
unreadable.
Yeah, that's true.
So the fundamentals of web design still apply where things are built in columns, and we won't go know all that, but the height of the column is where you start really talking percentages. Mm-hmm. The height of a font, the weights can still be the same, mm-hmm. but you want a font to be a change in percentages.
Yes.
You don't want it to be readable at one point size on a desktop and then keep that point size on a smaller screen where it becomes unreadable.
Right, right, right.
For example, an icon on desktop may take up a third column mm-hmm. on a desktop version, but you may want it the entire width of the screen mm-hmm. On a mobile version.
Yeah.
So we work in percentages, and without going totally into all of that, we do want fonts to change sizes. We do want iconography, which mostly now are fonts, to change sizes. Mm-hmm. We want images to change heights mm-hmm. and take up, if it takes up 50% of your landscape version on desktop, do you still want it to take up 50% on portrait or a quarter?
Mm-hmm.
Yep. And if it only takes up a quarter on portrait, you may have more room underneath to show
right.
more stuff that
right.
you would have had underneath on desktop.
True.
So you can still fit the same things,
right.
but they may proportionally be different to each other.
So any other mobile constraints that you want to tell us about before we move on to the next question?
Yeah, I think one thing you really want to think about, which is different between mobile and desktop when you're doing a mobile-first design, is to think about the margins on the side of your page.
Mm-hmm.
Because real estate comes at such a premium on a mobile device, you don't have the wide margin side to side, or you shouldn't.
Yeah.
And what you tend to see is that the padding on each side of the text or the margins disappears on a mobile device. You have a couple pixels instead. You don't want it right up against the side. You want to be able to still see the font,
mm-hmm.
but you reduce it on a mobile phone. But then when you get to tablet and desktop, they tend to expand and you have wider white space and you make
yeah.
a cleaner aesthetic.
Yeah, you have a bigger canvas to work with and you want it mm-hmm. to be more pleasing to the eye. You have more real estate there to work with. So,
mm-hmm.
okay.
The only other thing that I wanted to mention is how an image looks portrait on a mobile phone versus landscape.
Mm,
and think about where it's really challenging to start a web project and talking to a photographer and saying, here's how much white space around the shot I need on the raw file because I need to play with this file
mm-hmm.
and I need a buffer around this headshot
right here.
Because when we go to portrait, I need this part you can't see underneath us
right now
to show up.
Right.
And
yeah.
if a logo is going to go here,
uh-huh.
we need to both shift a little bit and do some stuff. So,
so
you really talk to the photographer about, I don't want a cropped finished image.
Mm-hmm.
Because I need the space that you can't see right now so that when it shifts, I can show that.
Interesting. So you don't achieve that space with CSS? Or
we do, but we need a non-cropped area.
Got it.
If you provide me an image where this is already taken away,
right.
I can't show it.
Right, right. That makes sense.
So the idea of a finished image is a totally different thing
oh.
than working with. Because I can go in either with CSS or with certain themes and say, well, when it goes to mobile, pan the image this way
mm-hmm.
and shift us. So we're center
right.
on desktop,
right.
but then on mobile we're off to the side or below
right.
or up, down,
okay.
and that kind of stuff.
So you need more of the image to be available so that you can adjust it accordingly on mobile versus desktop.
Yep.
Okay.
We could probably do a whole class on mobile first imagery for photographers.
You know, that's not a really good idea because I'll bet that most photographers don't think
Never,
about these things.
No.
Really? I mean,
they want to do the Photoshop and then send it over.
Right.
And I'm typically going back and saying, I need the raw file.
Right.
And I wish you had shot it a few zoomed out versions so
yeah.
that I have all this area to move people around. And just like when you grab your phone and you kind of drag and drop and slide
right.
an image around like that,
right.
that's what I need to be able to do.
Okay.
If I don't have extra space,
yeah.
I can't do that.
Then you're limited in your design options. That's really interesting. So mobile considerations for photographers
mm-hmm.
is a constraint.
Mm-hmm.
All right, I learned something new today. I love this. Okay, so I guess my next question before we wrap up is statement and a question. A lot of clients these days are resistant to mobile. It's not that they aren't aware of it or they aren't aware of the advantages, but why do you think there's still a resistance in some clients' minds to going the mobile first design direction versus the graceful degradation that you mentioned earlier?
First of all, it's change, right? So we're all resistant to change, whether we admit it or not. It's innovative.
Yeah.
It's relatively new, still in the big picture. Mm-hmm. You've got years of print before digital, then you've got years of digital before mobile. Mm-hmm. Now we've only got a few real good years of mobile.
Yep.
And you still have people doing native apps that are not responsive.
Right, that's true.
There's responsive within that, but they're not responding to totally different environments.
Process.
And there's a lot of apps that won't go landscape or portrait or vice versa, especially games. Most games or a lot of games are one or the other.
Okay.
And that makes their job infinitely easier.
Mm-hmm.
A website, I don't get to do that. I don't get to lock it down and say, no, you're not going to twist your screen.
Right.
So anyway, with the resistance is just one, because it's changed, but two, there are people who are designing and they want to upsell the website, but they may not be a web designer. So there's the element of who's building it and who's outsourcing it and subbing it out.
Mm-hmm.
I do a lot of subbed out work for a lot of agencies in town.
Right. Print agencies or ad agencies?
Both. Okay. Even agencies that say they're full service, but they need more horsepower because they're maxed out.
Right,
they need somebody to do it for them. Whether it's the account manager and whether they've done a mobile project before or anyone else on the team, maybe a design-only agency.
Desktop design.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Maybe, or print-only.
Right.
They may not have done any websites and definitely haven't done any mobile with that.
Mm-hmm.
So you want to make sure that you're working with people who've done some mobile stuff, you've seen their mobile stuff.
Yeah.
The other is approaching it from a new mindset. And I think one of the things we talked about earlier was when a web project kicks off, what kind of things does a client do? And the most commonly asked question of a client is, send me a few links to websites you like.
Mm.
And I think the challenge that we talked about earlier that we wanted to give you guys is, if you're thinking about your next website, don't just look at desktop. Find some websites on mobile that you like, that you love. Look at what they are on mobile, look at how they are on desktop, start comparing the two, educate yourself, and start, you don't have to know how it works to see that it works. And think about your site and what you want from a mobile perspective first, and then send those to the client and say, to the vendor and say, hey, I like how these look on mobile, what do you think?
Yeah.
And start the conversation that way.
Yeah.
And that will make sure that the entire project unfolds in a mobile first way.
I think that's great advice, and I will add to that regarding the resistance that a lot of companies, especially big established companies, I've worked at some of the big ones as a consultant, they established their branding guidelines 10, 20 years ago, maybe even 30 years ago or longer, depending upon how big and old the company is. They established these branding guidelines before mobile was even a thing. And certainly not mobile design and mobile apps. So they've got these branding guidelines which work for a desktop, they work for print, but they're not necessarily going to work for mobile, but they still kind of have this, they cling to their old guidelines and don't want to redo their branding, which is, that's a big effort. I mean, I've worked with marketing departments, so I know how that goes. So I understand the resistance from a perspective of not wanting to do extra work, but I think that's an added bonus, if you will, why companies are resistant.
One of the first things I do when I kick off a project is ask for the brand cookbook or the style guide, the brand guidelines, whatever you want to call it.
Yeah.
Owner operators typically don't have them. And for those guys, we typically make them as part of the project.
That's very good.
Because we found it always works to take best practices from large corporations into the small businesses, because there was a reason they do those.
Yeah.
It minimizes the risk of design changes and everything within the project.
Yeah.
You don't have to approach every page and reinvent the wheel if you've got a book that says these are the fonts, these are the colors,
right,
these are the treatments.
Right.
Follow these.
Right.
Yeah. And it's easier to project manage when you can just hand it to the actual guy doing the grunt work and say, hey, it's all in there.
Yeah.
So that's part of it.
That's true.
But one thing we do when we make a brand guideline is we talk about Not only how does the font look when it's on an all black background? Does it go white or do the colors stay there? Mm-hmm. How does it look on all white? Does it go black? What is it on transparent? La da 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 da. What does it look like on a mug, a truck? What do the wraps look like? All these things you put in a style guide. We also start talking about the different size screens. And you don't see that even in some of the big corporations a lot. So it's a real good opportunity to push back to anybody and say, all right, well, I see your brand book. What do you want to, let's talk about mobile first. Mm-hmm. Let's set the stage before even starting the project. So there's mobile first, as in we're going to design it first, but there's also putting it first before you even start.
Yeah, as a priority. Mm-hmm. And I will say, as a consultant, putting my consultant hat back on for a moment, I will always be totally upfront and just laid out on the table with any clients that I have. And I've done this when I've worked for consulting companies. I do it on my own as a freelancer. My advice is to design for mobile first because, you know, we've talked about the stats. We've talked about the design process and how much more difficult it is if you don't think of mobile first, but you want to include that in the design. So there are all these reasons why companies should design for mobile first. And as a consultant, I'm just going to say, you know, this is my recommendation, and I'm not going to waver from that. You will do it the way you see fit according to your constraints, but this is my recommendation as a professional in this industry. And that's one of the reasons why I bring Kyle on to this show repeatedly is because he knows his stuff. And we're going to talk about the Mammoth Solutions approach in just a second. But I will say, even as a consultant myself, I mean, I've done some web design in the past before mobile was a thing. So I started out as a web designer earlier in my career, but then I moved into project management and into business analysis. So I have not kept up really to the extent that somebody like Kyle does with the latest design techniques, the latest paradigms, how to design for mobile, all the technicalities of that. You know, that's why you need somebody like Kyle advising you. He knows his stuff. He has kept current with it. And, you know, I have my specialty, so I don't need to know all the intricacies of mobile design. I'd hire Kyle
for that. If you need a project manager, she obviously knows more about it than most.
Right. So we have our different specialties. But, again, this is the reason I got him here in the first place. It's not just that he does this kind of dabbles in it. This is his business, and he has kept current throughout the years as things have changed. So he knows what the old approach is and why that doesn't work anymore and why we need to move on from that. So given that, what is the Mammoth Solutions ideal recommendation that you would give to a client? What's your approach?
Yeah, so we've got the right way, the wrong way, the mammoth way.
Yeah. Somewhere in between is the mammoth way.
Yeah. We've created five groups of CSS classes, or all you need to know is options of design that you can choose from. And when you say, oh, I like that style, we're going to ask you to put it in one of five buckets, other than global, which is put it everywhere. The mobile-only version, the tablet-only version, the desktop-only version, or the mobile and tablet version.
Sorry, go ahead.
Or the tablet and desktop version. Those are the five non-global buckets. Classic example, so this isn't all conceptual, is the hamburger menu. You know how you have a full text menu and then you've got the little three lines and that you see on mobile, that's called a hamburger menu. Mm-hmm. Some people want the hamburger menu only on mobile or only on tablet or on tablet and mobile. Mm-hmm. So the five groups of choices for CSS classes and how you want your site to respond are mobile only, tablet only, desktop only, and desktop and tablet, or tablet and mobile. If it's not one of those, the only one we didn't list is mobile and desktop, where you exclude tablet, and that just doesn't make any sense to us. I haven't been able to imagine a situation where you want mobile to act the same as desktop, leave tablet out.
Right.
So those are the five classes.
So if there is a feature on a website that I like, that I see, you know, somewhere in mobile land, for instance, how they treat the menu treatment. I'm going to go to Kyle and say, I like this menu treatment here. Maybe I see it on my mobile phone on somebody's website. And you're going to ask me, okay, do you want that treatment only on the mobile device, or do you also want it on tablet, or do you want it on the desktop, et cetera? So you're going to go feature by feature. Is that it?
Yeah. When we start seeing differences, Right. Okay. That's when we're going to go in.
But, okay.
And we can do it to any element on the website.
Okay. Oh, interesting. Okay. So you've got these five CSS classes that you, or maybe groups of classes,
mm-hmm.
that you have developed so that when your client sees an experience, let's just call it an experience, no matter mm-hmm. where that is, they can choose where they want that experience to appear in their website or application or mobile site, and then you design accordingly.
Correct.
Using the mobile-first approach.
Yep.
Okay. Very important. Great. Okay. I think we have covered a lot today. We've covered the stats of mobile usage, just some high-level stats. I'm sure you can go on Google and find many more deep stats and stats to your heart's content. But we've really just kind of covered what's important to know for why you should be considering mobile design first.
Mm-hmm.
We've talked about what mobile design is and how that's different from responsive design. We talked about some of the constraints. We talked about why you should look at mobile design first and some client resistance and maybe how to overcome that and how to justify this approach. And we talked about the mammoth approach.
Mm-hmm.
And
we've talked a lot.
Yeah, we have. We've done quite a lot. And and we had a blooper in between all that where my card ran out of room, so we had to retape some of this. So, but Kyle's been great. I'm so glad to have you here because
it is good to be back.
Yeah, you're so knowledgeable, and it's just like
thanks.
Every time I talk to you and we do a video together, I'm like, God, I wish I could keep him here for another hour or two because there's so many other things that I want to pick your brain about. But
my team says, Kyle, you have a lot of experience because experience is the name we give our mistakes. That's their
good.
Backhanded compliment.
Very good. Very good. Okay, so how can people find you? They want to find your work mm-hmm. online or your agency or you specifically?
Yeah, there's always LinkedIn or Google, mm-hmm. Google Kyle Rollins, but my agency is Mammoth Solutions, and you can find us at mammoth.solutions.
Great. And you can read, I know you have a blog on there, mm-hmm. and you've posted some of the videos that we've done.
Yeah.
So there's lots of information you can get besides just the, hey, here we are, Mammoth Solutions, here's what we do. There's a lot of additional info that they provide in the blog to their site. So definitely check out mammoth.solutions. Look up Kyle, hit him up if you have some need or want to work with him. He knows his stuff. I would not have him on the show if he didn't. So that's the bottom line.
Thanks.
So, and if you are watching this video, please leave a comment below, ask us a question, give us your opinion. What do you think about this episode? Has it been helping you to learn more about mobile design and the approach that you will take?
Mm-hmm.
Leave us a comment and we'll answer. I'll answer if it's for Kyle. I will send it his way or have him answer. Tracy can answer as well if you have other questions that she can answer. If you are listening to this on iTunes, please give us a review and hit those star buttons. That will help us be found in iTunes, which will help us keep creating more great content for you to build your business and succeed. So please like, please share, please let us know what you think. Check out howbusinessreallyworks.com. Check out mammoth.solutions. And we will see you on the next episode. Bye-bye.
See you.